we'll go with the red pepper crostini, and then we'll do a dill one for the salmon crostini. Just so you can get it to consistency that's more easily spread. Sort of like step above yogurt. Which is, I think, not going to happen right now.
Well, this ain't even perfect yet, right?
No. That's, of course, the nice thing is I can kind of let it sit for a while, and then you're all good. Nobody knows.
How about you haven't even put the bread in?
Okay, so we're roasting red pepper here. Basically what we do is we poke holes in it so the hot air will not blow up the red pepper, and then we coat it in olive oil. You want the oven on broil, and you want it in the highest rack. You just go ahead and put that in, and then when you start to see the top blacken, just move it around so you keep getting black edges. Okay, so now it's been about 10 minutes, and we are getting our red pepper out of the oven. You want all sides blackened, so we've been moving it every couple minutes just to make sure it's all getting blackened. And then what you want to do is put it immediately either into a paper bag or a bowl with a cloth over it will work. What that will help do is create steam so that the skin is easier to get off. Okay, so we just pulled the crostini out of the oven, which is basically just bread with olive oil on it, put until it's toasted at about 350. And then we're going to just spread on a bunch of our chive cream cheese mixture. You want to get a fair amount each, but not quite too much. And then at that point, we're going to just take our roasted red pepper, which came out of the oven, and we sliced. We peeled off about this much of the skin, it's about that thick, to make these really sweet individual little pieces that we then cut thinly. And we're now just going to top on the crostini and make a very pretty little piece like that. You can kind of play with it however you want to make it prettier or less pretty. And we'll just keep doing that. And as you can tell, we've cut the bread at about a half an inch thickness. It's a good size. Really kind of vary it depending on what you're putting on top. Obviously with stronger flavors, you can go with thicker slices of bread. If you're doing a more delicate flavor, slice your bread just a little bit thinner. Okay, so here we have the beginning of potatoes au gratin. Essentially what that means is any kind of potatoes with cheese. In this particular case, we sliced it pretty thinly. And the slices are probably about a quarter of an inch to an eighth of an inch. Try and keep them as uniform as possible so it'll cook evenly. We've also layered it with caramelized onions and blue cheese at this point. You can, of course, add anything you like. For example, bacon is quite good generally. So what we're doing now is putting the top layer on, and then we're gonna coat it in a milk, cheese and chive mixture. Then we're pouring over a mixture that is about a cup and a half to 2 cups milk and about a cup of cheese. You really can do this with whatever cheese you like. I prefer blue cheese, but it works great with cheddar as well or Gruyere. I'm trying to get the cheese a little bit even so it's kind of spread out, although I have a friend who doesn't like blue cheese, so it might be nice and leave some of it out a little. Although, apparently I'm not going to. Little dabs of butter on the top to create a kind of golden crust on it, and then just toss in the oven for about an hour at 350. So we're just finishing up our potatoes gratin here. When in doubt, with anything sort of brown on top, add some green, add some red, put some tomato on top, put some chives on top, put some parsley on top, and it just comes out much prettier. Albacore tuna. Albacore is a great tuna for non-fish eaters. It's pretty steak-like and not particularly fishy. It's also sort of the cheapest and most underrated in many ways of the tunas. Now, since we are doing permanent cooking here, we are going to be using a beer bottle to smash the tuna down so it cooks a little bit more evenly. You don't need to hit real hard, because the last thing you want to do is tear it up too bad. This is just a couple lines that we've cut up into smaller pieces that will fit in our not absolutely enormous pan. Gently pound it. You don't want to break any of it up, so just keep yourself gentle in that bottle. The next one to do is encrust it in a mixture of salt and pepper. It's kind of a coarse salt. Kerry sells green, which it tends to be coarser, and it's a kind of sweet salt. It generally is best for things where you roast too long for your time, like a chicken or a vegetable, something like that. But we're using it here because it's what we've got. So as soon as you've kind of gotten it in there, just go ahead and use your hands to get messy. put it in the pan that already has some olive oil in it and slightly preheated. It's cooking over about medium heat right now. We're going to boost it a little bit to get a nice brown crisp edge on that. And the nice thing, of course, about tuna is that you don't really have to worry about it cooking all the way through because it's actually great raw as well. Okay, so now we just pulled our fish off. Now we're going to make a quick white wine pan sauce. This is a great way to dress up pretty much any kind of meat, be it fish or poultry or beef is great. First thing you want to do is add some kind of fat to the pan or alcohol at a pretty high temp. That'll help get the scraping where it got stuck on the pan off. I'm adding some shallot because I really like the taste of it. You could add any kind of allium, would be great here. Garlic, shallot, onions, red or white would be wonderful. And we're also going to toss in some fresh garlic spears that happen to be in season. Now, these are not exactly for the economical cook here, but they're fantastic if you want to spring. It's a great way to do it. And we want to keep our temp kind of high here so everything just goes pretty quick. If you start to see your butter getting soaked up and everything, just toss some more in. Again, we're sort of doing capsicum meal here, so we're not going to be remotely shy with butter today. It's not quite sizzling as much as I want, so I just raised the heat a little to try and get a little more browning on these garlic spears. What I really want is a nice crisp color to them, and I want them to cook pretty quick so they don't actually wilt and get soggy, because soggy vegetables suck. Amen. I'm looking for my shallots to kind of take on a translucent color. That would be true with onions as well. They're starting to do here, but I'm going to let it go just a little bit longer because my garlic spears aren't quite where I want them yet. A whole bunch of wine. The wine's at a high heat, so you're going to hear that start hiss. And you're going to put more wine in than you think you should because it will reduce and it will do it quickly. When we're done with this, we have a nice, rich, thick sauce. We're just going to toss in some Italian parsley just for the sheer fun of it all. Italian parsley is also called flat leaf parsley. If you're cooking anything except tabbouleh, you should basically be using this and not the curly stuff. And given that they're the same price, there's really no excuse. Now we're just kind of waiting for the wine to boil. Obviously, you'll lose some alcohol content, which, seeing as we adhere strongly to the Julia Child school of cooking, we've been drinking the whole time, so it's just fine that we're going to lose the alcohol. Okay. Now the sauce has really reduced to the point I want. So I'm going to do, find a hot pad. And towel, apparently. And I'm just going to pick the whole thing up and dump it all over the fish, which is probably going to be messy because of these garlic spears. I'm just going to jiggle the pan off until I get everything I want. And use a trusty spatula. And whatever's on the bottom, invariably, whatever you're cooking, whatever's on the bottom is best. So make sure to scrape it all up and get it all in there. And then we're basically ready to eat. Now we're plating a tuna. I've cut it into smaller pieces because not everyone's up for a whole loin. The other thing we've done is taken those roast red peppers we did earlier that we had left over from crostini and just add them to the top. With the garlic spears, it's somewhat easiest to bend them in half and make them kind of pretty on top at sun angles. Fortunately, the potatoes came out beautifully. Plated pretty nicely. They're a little bit difficult to keep together, so you sort of want to use your fingers a bit. It's slid off pretty well there. And then we're just dishing up the salad, pretty much as is. You can sort of find kind of central piece, like there's an orange in the salad that's on top. That's always great. And we're going to spoon some of our white wine pan sauce that we made onto the top of the tuna. The tuna will just suck that up, and fortunately, white wine is good with pretty much everything, so you're on a great streak there with both your potatoes and with your salad.
these yards where tourists snore in the cage. And when they dance in a reptile blaze, you wear a mask, an equatorial haze into the past, a colonial maze where there's no more confetti to throw.